body is made up of a variety of biomolecules, and one such is nucleic acid, which performs several important functions like storing and transferring of genetic information done by DNA, whereas RNA codes for amino acids, which serves as messenger in the process of protein synthesis. One such remarkable property of nucleic acid is their complementary base pairing, which forms the basis of many biological techniques being used in human welfare. Hello everyone, I am Dr. Deepika Jolania Tomar, welcomes you at Zoolophyte, and in this lecture, we shall be discussing about nucleic acid hybridization. We all know that RNA and DNA are nucleic acid, and hybridization is a process by which either two single-stranded DNA or one single-stranded DNA and RNA combines by a complementary base pairing and forms a one hybrid molecule. One hybrid molecule, like if two single-stranded DNA combines together, then they form a one DNA hybrid, and this is called as DNA hybridization. Similarly, if one single-stranded DNA combines with RNA, then they form DNA-RNA hybrid. And this is called as DNA-RNA hybridization. In both these processes, DNA hybridization and DNA-RNA hybridization forms the basis of nucleic acid hybridization. So, the basic principle on which nucleic acid hybridization work is complementary base pairing. Further, under nucleic acid hybridization, we will be discussing the following techniques. First is in situ hybridization. Second one is blotting techniques. And in blotting techniques, we can discuss northern blotting, southern blotting, western blotting, and dot blotting. Third, colony hybridization. In situ hybridization, which is also called as FISH. Let's start with in situ hybridization. This technique is basically used to localize specific DNA sequence and here we use label, and here single stranded DNA or RNA as prop. In in situ hybridization, first of all we take chromosome in squash preparation. Then we denature them. By our alkaline treatment, the DNA present in chromosome is double stranded, and we have to convert them into single stranded DNA so that they can complementarily base paired by a labeled prop. And for this we need to do denaturing, and this step of denaturation serves two basic functions. First, it releases the DNA from a protein frame, basically the stone proteins which are present on DNA and the coil tip. And secondly, it converts double stranded DNA to single stranded DNA, and after that we load them by a radioactive single stranded probe. This allow them to hybridize. Then washing is needed to remove unhybrid probes. This step of washing is repeated 2 to 3 times so that all the unhybridized probes get removed. And after that, the area of or areas of radioactivity are determined by the technique called autoradiography. Let's see how autoradiography is used to detect the areas of radioactivity. This technique basically used to detect the areas of radioisotopes or radioisotopes present in solid sample on gel membrane. In the protocol of autoradiography, first the chromosome squash is covered with photofilm or photographic emulsion. This photographic emulsion contains silver crystal, silver halide crystal, and then we store it in a dark place for several days or weeks, and after that examine it under light microscope. Where we found that the areas of radioactivity shows a silver grains. Areas of radioactivity shows silver grains, radioactive decay. The reason of formation of silver grains is radioactive decay, wherein when the beta particle or gamma rays from radioactive substance move to emulsion, move to photographic emulsion, then this convert silver ions into silver atoms, and this conversion of silver ions to silver atoms leads to the formation of these silver grains, which are detectable under light microscope. Now we will discuss the uses of in situ hybridization. First, in situ hybridization is used to localize specific DNA sequence. Example, sac DNA in chromosome. Next, it is also used to locate specific gene, especially in giant chromosome in salivary gland of Drosophila. And in situ hybridization is also used to in the diagnosis of diseases, particularly viruses in cells or tissues. That's all for this lecture, and in the next lecture we're going to discuss blotting techniques. Till then, have a good day.